So good morning, Roaring Brook Lake. That is, welcome to the third Roaring Brook Lake Zoom meeting of this pandemic season. We are very grateful for Tony Ariane's help and the town's support of being able to do this kind of meeting. And it's a pleasant part of it that we actually have really more attendance than we usually have at in-person meetings. So we're sorry that we can't be together, but we're glad to have this technology. We have already talked about lake ecology in some depth at our last district meeting. Now we're going to be moving more to some of the interactional and community aspects of living in this wonderful community. And it's my pleasure to once again introduce somebody who needs no introduction, Sam Oliverio. But I think I mentioned last time that Sam is an ardent fan of Putnam Valley. He appreciates all the things that we appreciate, the lakes, the trees, the calm, the beauty of it, and the people. And he is such an actively involved supervisor. He's in a normal year, he's around all the time, shaking people's hands and letting them pet Memphis and just being part of the community and getting to know all of us. We so appreciate it, and we're so glad to have him here running this district meeting about a number of topics that are of great importance to us. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you. Thank you, Anna.
Oh, I'm going to mute all, Sam. I'll need you to unmute. Just a
moment. No problem. That's fine.
Okay. You can unmute.
Yeah. Okay. We're good, Tony. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you all for being here today. I know it's a Saturday morning, kind of gray, but we will survive it as we did last night, the tropical depression. I want to hit on a broad scheme and then bring it very close to Roaring Brook and some specifics for the district itself. I want to first talk about taxes because they're going to affect us all in 2021. The tax situation is dire. The state, as you know, is in the hole approximately $18 billion and constantly increasing in their deficit, and understandably so. The sales tax is less. There's less people going out, shopping, going to restaurants, things like that. And the need for governmental intervention, that is food stamps, welfare recipients, unemployment, and things like that, is huge. So you have a real maelstrom hitting the state, and that affects us here at the municipality. Effective with this budget, I will not accept anything but a 0% increase from every department and every agency that we contract with or that we are part of. It's that simple. We can't go above that. Salaries are contractual. They will be honored, but they're only 1 or 1.5%. Per year. That's what we settled, so that's not too bad. The maximum is a 2% increase. But everything else, departmentally, and I'm looking at the districts as well to try to hold them within the boundary of a 0% increase. That affects us all. And these tough times, and that is the reality of our new, in quote, normal. COVID-19 has brought about some drastic changes all over. And now I'm going to bring it closer to the district. With COVID-19, we are limited by the participation on our beaches. The Department of Health can close down at a minute if we exceed the maximum capacity, which is half of what we normally would allow on the beaches. If they come down and inspect it and see that that maximum capacity of half of what we normally would have is exceeded, they can close us down. They have the power to do that, the Department of Health. And they will do that. They did that at Lake Cassie, and they did it at Lake Carmel recently. People were just excited to get out, understandably so, but we have to follow the mandates that's set by the governor's executive orders. So I know there was some controversy on Facebook about large crowds at the beaches. That was a lucky weekend. The Department of Health is sending out their people more and more on weekends when they anticipate the beaches to be crowded, because this fear of COVID-19 is real. It's devastating. I recently lost another friend to it, a gentleman I worked with at the schools, Frank Reality back in March, and Mr. Ed Kenny now recently. And that is a very sad thing. So it's still alive and well with us, and we're trying to prevent it. So masks are required if you're not swimming, half capacity. And, you know, we ask you, please bring some hand sanitizer with you down to the beaches as well. These are public beaches for Roaring Brook residents only and their family or friends. And I put that friends in quote, it's limited. You can't bring 100 people down there and claim they're all your friends. It's not going to work. The district is a quasi-governmental body of the town. Whatever the district does, the town's insurance and governance overlies the district. So it's like a political entity. So what happens at the public district beaches for the residents of that various community impact the town and the district as well, i.e. that rope swing. Look, I swang on that many years ago, about 50 years ago or so. I used that to dive off of Cardiac Beach. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. And when you're 17 years old, I don't think there's anything more exciting than to swing that, land in the water, people screaming and yelling. But because the town is aware of this rope swing, you know, in the old days, 50 years ago, nobody cared about anything. Nobody was suing everybody en masse. Now it's a different story. Somebody gets hurt on that rope swing, and the town knows about it. And we do know about it now. We are liable. The district is liable. You could end up bankrupting the town, bankrupting the district. So I have cut it twice, and I will cut it again every time it's up there. It cannot be there. Let me tell you about the district beaches and how they work. They're controlled by the Department of Health and the town through its governance of the district itself, this quasi-municipal configuration. Nobody can vandalize, cut down vegetation, do anything, add anything or retract or take anything from these district beaches without consent of the entire district and the town itself. It's that simple. That's the law. And it will be enforced. We can't have people freewheeling on these beaches. And even the boat ramps still come over our jurisdiction, Ferber and the others. We, the town and the district, control those. They are owned by the district and the town, not by any one individual or family. So if you do a rope swing on a district beach, that's vandalism. If you go and cut vegetation without permission of the district or the town, that's vandalism, and it will be enforced. And I know it sounds harsh. Believe me, like I said, 50 years ago, the laws were not the way they were written. But today, we have to protect the standing of the district and the town. That's paramount. And I will do that, and the town board will do that. The district is quasi-municipal government, and as such, we have to protect its integrity. And we will do that by enforcing rules and regulations that govern districts and the town. So I know there's been discussion about the rope swing, been discussion about vegetation being removed. None of that can happen unless the district approves it. Now, when does the district, or when can the district approve something? Well, definitely during budget season, which will occur at the end of August and then in early September. That's when your budget is put together. You come before the town and you request what you'd like to see done. We can't put something in the district that could endanger somebody. The rope swing can endanger someone. So if someone asks, let's do a rope swing at Moon Beach, let's say, that can't happen. Anything that puts the district or the town in a position where liability could very well happen, you know, an attractive nuisance. We can't do that, but we can do docks. We can do extra porta potties and anything that may be of necessity or desire within, rational means. It's that simple. Now, if there's a need, and I'm going to go to the security guard, which I've heard a lot about, and I've been pricing them, a uniformed, trained, insured security guard from one of the agencies, and that's what we would have to use as a town and as a district, if you wanted a security guard without a gun, that would run approximately $30 to $40 an hour. So depending upon how long you would want this individual there, checking beaches, tags, whatever it may be, you would have to consider the cost. That's the cheapest for a trained, insured, reputable security guard. Right now we have a monitor who goes around, but they're not enforcement people, and I don't expect them to be, nor does the district. We rely a lot on the integrity of the individuals within the district. Same for Lake Osquana, same for Lake Peekskill. We have not had the issues in Lake Peekskill and Lake Osquana, it seems, as we've had in Roaring Brook. And I can attribute that to one main factor. And I believe, and it's something that I've asked the board to discuss. We have it on this meeting this Wednesday, an initial discussion. But I'm going to talk about the Airbnbs, because that directly impacts Roaring Brook. And it has been a powerful occurrence that has started to reshape the community to where you have many individuals from out of town who want to rest, want a vacation, want some less urban stress, and come to your beautiful area, and it's gorgeous. I love Roaring Brook. It is quiet and it's beautiful. But these individuals come there in all innocence, renting a place, and then find out that they can't go down to the beaches, you know, unless they're part of a family or, friends who are residents there. They just can't show up. That's not allowed. Nor can they take boats that may be somewhere along the lake and use them, which has happened. Nor have parties in the middle of the night, leaving trash, beer bottles, and things like that within the parking area, which has happened. The Airbnb are a real concern, not only for Roaring Brook, for Lake Osquana as well, and to a small extent, Lake Peekskill also. My own feeling, it's my personal feeling, I cannot make a decision on this based upon my feeling. We need a public hearing townwide for this, but my preference is we ban them. We simply ban them. They're not allowed in Putnam Valley. Why do I believe that? Because I've seen too many communities alter in appearance and alter in character with these Airbnbs. Individuals come in who are not tied to the community, who are transients, and there are individuals who own these Airbnbs making a lot of money on them. They wouldn't do it unless they can make money. You know, that's the whole profit motivation. And over time, what happens is that neighbors start getting upset. And I've seen this in some upstate communities, but especially in Europe, that what's happening to our community? The Joneses who live there are no longer there. There's people we don't recognize on the weekends. And eventually there's a movement almost of leaving the area, of the families who are here year round, and it becomes a transient community. And I grew up in Putnam Valley. I've been here since 1954. And I'll be a son of a gun if I want to see that happen to any of our lake districts or anywhere in town. But again, I'm one person. It takes at least three to pass a resolution and a lot of public input. So we're going to begin this conversation in August about the Airbnbs. I'm not a fan. I am not. And I, just like I'm not a fan of development in town, you know, my favorite expression is welcome to Putnam Valley. Welcome to Putnam County. Buy one of the houses for sale. Don't go ripping up the green and building a new one. We got many beautiful houses for sale. Buy one of them. That's why I've been big on preservation of land with our park, our camp, our summer camp, also Granite Mountain. These are important aspects of who we are and what we are. Look, we don't have a business section. We don't have railroads coming through the town. What we have is green, beautiful mountains, beautiful lakes, beautiful forests. That's what makes Putnam Valley so powerfully, beautifully, beautiful and wonderful, and why people want to move here. Houses have been selling so fast that it's less than 2 weeks on the market to get a sale now. I know a lot of that has to do with people moving out of the city. I saw it when 9/11 occurred, and I saw it when other issues occurred back in the 80s. There's a mass movement right now, and I don't want to see those houses sold to individuals who are only going to rent them out to transients. That's not what we're about. I'm happy that most of the sales that are going on right now are going to families with young kids and going to put them in our schools and going to add to the community. So again, getting back to the original tenet that I was making, the beaches this year and the property that we have, it seems to be causing a lot of consternation. Again, I put it to many of the rentals that are going on through Airbnb. Family is family. You live here all year round. You have a right to use the lakes. You have the right to use the beaches. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. But again, that Airbnb issue will be discussed later in this year. I'm going to begin the discussion this Wednesday, just opening up to the board and then asking them to start thinking about it. You know, the one compromise I would make on it is that if you have an Airbnb and you reside in the home, like the original Airbnb was developed in California, you rented a room, maybe with a bathroom attached, but the person was there. I would feel much more comfortable about that because the owner and that integrity of year-round existence still is there with that home, with that house, and that's important. So I would compromise on that and allow Airbnb as long as its owner occupied. And I also want to talk about the Deconic and the overpass. I got some very good news about that recently, and that is they seem to be almost 3 to 4 months ahead of time. The weather's been very good for them. If you notice, and I'm sure everybody in Roaring Brook has noticed, you can see that the supports are there. The actual roadbed is being laid right now. They have the new entrance. Well, it's not the exit onto Wicopee, but off of Wicopee heading south is there. That little junky turnoff is dangerous. And I said that to the DOT reps. It's not permanent. The permanent one will come over the hilltop, over the mountain, and down into Wicopee to get off the Deconic. But about 4 months early, which means this could be done, fully completed, hopefully, by sometime late spring, early summer of next year. That's what it's looking like. Now, come the fall, I've been told the overpass itself will be connected somewhat, not for use, to Roaring Brook and Wicopee on both sides, which means our emergency service vehicles might be able to utilize that in the event of an emergency. I believe that's what they're charting. I don't know the exact date, but I've heard rumors to that effect. I've spoken to the project manager, so that looks good. I know your community has suffered with this a very long time. And, you know, the construction has really caused a lot of inconvenience, but it's getting there. You can see it every time you leave that area, you know, to head north and then come back down, head south. I've done it many times myself. But it's there and it's getting completed. I think right now that's about as update as I can be with some of the issues. We can open it up for questions now.
Well, thank you. Just unmute myself.
Yeah, you're unmuted, Ina.
I'm unmuted, okay. Yes. So thank you very much, Sam. Just a little bit of housekeeping. We already have about 15 questions.
Sure.
And we're gonna start with those questions, but our questions are going to be read by our board member, John Groach, who's standing by to do that. And we'll also try to maybe even clump a few questions together when they seem like they have the same topic, but we're going to try to get to as many as possible. And that's one reason we're having you write them in the chat box and then read them. I do want to say that sometimes people really do want to ask their own question. We can accommodate that. You can either write, I have a question in the chat box, or you can, if you can figure it out, which is not.
That's probably the best way to do it. I have a question I'd like to ask it myself.
Yeah, then we'll call on you and we'll have people, it'll be organized and we'll unmute your microphone.
Sure.
With that, I'm going to hand it over to John and to the first of our questions.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes, John. Yeah.
Okay, great. First group of questions are around what the meaning of public beach is. Lois asked a question that was followed by a few people, including Sam. I think some clarification around what the nature of these Roaring Brook Lake beaches is the general theme. What's private, sure. What's public?
Okay, private is owned by a single individual who has lake rights. That's a private beach. Anything that the district pays taxes on, all the residents combined together paying taxes on the maintenance and the upkeep of the beaches, whether it's your boat launches or your actual swim beaches, those are for district residents only. Nobody from out of the area can use them because it's your taxes that support them. And they are run by your district residents under the auspices of the town. For instance, if Moon Beach needs a new lifeguard stand, during budget process, that request would come to us and we would purchase it. And that money would be raised through the district taxes. Anything that is tax driven by the residents, those beaches, those boat launches, those are strictly for use by the Roaring Brook residents, their families, their friends. Anything else is private and the town has no power, nor does the district have power over those private beaches, other than our ordinance that govern dock building and things like that. I hope that clarifies that.
I think so. There are sort of numerous questions about that. And Sam, I think what it looks like is people would want more information just generally. Where is that information available? Maybe we could even post it after this meeting so that people could find a place to read it.
What information in particular?
The rules and regulations that apply at the district beaches.
Those were, when Roaring Brook was incorporated, and we're talking quite a few years ago, well over 50 years ago, those were the rules and regulations as established by the district. It's your tax dollars. It's called a lake district with services provided, a service district as well. We take care of your garbage. We take care of your beaches. We hire your lifeguards and all that. There's no rules specific other than as they apply to each individual district. And I would have to find the deed and the charter that established Roaring Brook to share that with everybody.
Okay.
But basically, if your taxes pay for it, that is a district and a town joint entity. And I don't know what rules they're looking for other than that is how districts are formed. I can also get it from the state and we can post it under districts.
There's a specific question. Who is responsible for stopping people from entering our beaches when at capacity?
The lifeguards are supposed to call the head of the lifeguards, Teresa Orlando, who will in turn call me. The difficulty is this, the lifeguards are not enforcement. They're there to save lives. That's their main job. The best they can do is to say, uh-oh, we're over capacity, make announcement and say, listen, I can only have, 20 people here. I've got like 40. Can some of you please leave? Now, of course, they're not going to push the issue. They are told not to push the issue. They report it to me. And then, I contact the Department of Health. That is my responsibility and say, we have so many people on the beach. What do you want to do? Then it becomes, it goes into their hands. I have had to do that at Lake Peekskill once this year already. What happened is the Department of Health said if I could take a drive down there and tell that, you know, the individuals that they needed to reduce the amount on North Beach, that they either left, or if they didn't, then I had the authority under their auspices to close the beach. Thank goodness a bunch of people did move on to another beach that they had available, Carreras. So we were lucky about that. But that would be basically the same thing. If Park Beach is too full, go to Children's. If Children's is too full, you know, go to Moon Beach. Moon Beach is too full, you have the Toddler Beach over at Spur. So there are other avenues. You know, is it going to become a war with this? No. I ask people to just be reasonable. You got a very serious pandemic going on. Don't fly in the face of it. You know, this is important.
Okay, there are a couple of questions that are similar regarding the rope swing. One of the questions is, are there creative solutions we could look for that would allow a rope swing to exist?
Only on private property, and that person would be liable for any injuries. It cannot go on beach property. It cannot. It is a liability. Our insurance company has made it very clear to us. We will not cover any incidences of injury. It's an attractive nuisance. If you know about it and it's there, you can be sued and you can bankrupt the town. So I'm not going to play with that. You cannot put this rope swing anywhere on one of the public beaches. Now, there's multiple. I mean, Roaring Brook is made up of more private beaches than public. There is more land devoted to the private homeowner than there is to the district itself. Somebody wishes to put a rope swing up in their backyard, God bless you. You know, I wouldn't do it, but if you wish to, you can. That's the only way it can be done.
Good. There's a question about fishing. What are the regulations with regard to fishing, either from a boat or on the beaches?
You can definitely fish from a boat, but again, only residents of Roaring Brook are allowed to do that. We've had to call the sheriff on an individual who kept coming in, you know, trying to catch the carp, which are very difficult to catch anyway, but all the other fish there. And the person was from out of town. He was issued a ticket, and he did appear in court. This was last year. We have asked the sheriff to increase patrols for that as well. Fishing from any swim beach is not allowed because of the hooks and things like that. There are people swimming. You can't fish while people are swimming at the swim beaches. But you have the boat launch beaches that you can, you know, fish from offshore. You have a boat you can fish off of. That's all allowed. But
and is a New York State fishing or DEC license required for?
Yes, correct. Yes, thank you. Yes, absolutely.
I happen to know anyone who wants one can get one immediately online. You need to make a payment depending on your age and what type of license you want.
Also, they're available at Town Hall right now as well. Thank you.
I think the next questions get to be Airbnb category. I don't know.
I'd like to hold on the Airbnb questions simply because there's going to be a plethora of public hearings on that issue. Right now, I know there's going to be some people who want the Airbnb, some people who are opposed. We have discussed this previously. We had a huge public hearing. A lot of people showed up. I thought it was excellent, but then the ball got dropped because we had so many other issues come before us. I'm picking the ball back up, and it's going to be open court for that. That will occur towards the end of the summer and into the fall. Again, I'm going to propose, and probably the compromise, that if you live in the home, you certainly can utilize it as an Airbnb if that is your residence. Outside of that, I'm going to ask for an outright banning. But I don't make that decision. I need a majority vote, and we have to have public hearings. So we could go on forever just on Airbnb. There will be a time and a place to discuss that in the very near future.
Right. Yeah, I would say the chat has a lot of comments and thoughts, not necessarily any other questions.
I have access to the chat, so I will be reading all of them as well, pertaining to the Airbnb, just to get a tenor to see what residents of RBL would like to see happen.
There is a question from an attendee and resident. What can be done about theft, poaching from someone's yard? They've lost a few items. Is that to be brought to the attention of the sheriff, or how do we deal with that?
The sheriff, yeah. 845-225-4300. Or the state police. The state police have been responding quite a bit as well. Either agency, that's theft. That's theft. The town has no enforcement capabilities now. We used to have a police department that was disbanded in 1997. And since then, we've relied heavily upon the sheriff and the state troopers. So if you have any type of encroachment or theft of your property, you need to call the sheriff and immediately. Don't hesitate. This is your property. You have a right to it. Nobody should be taking it.
Okay. Another attendee suggested car tags, and I think the issue has come up before. Can we just talk about how we can identify actual residents and or their guests versus outside people who come here for the day to use the lake without permission?
I'm going to use Lake Osquana as an example. Lake Osquana, unlike Roaring Brook and Lake Peekskill, is not one solid district. It's multiple districts, Abley Park, Wildwood Knolls, Lookout, Hilltop, etc. A couple of the districts require car tags that if you go, especially Hilltop has a big parking lot, if you park in the Hilltop parking lot to use the beach, you had better have one of the parking tags that designate you as a part of that district. They're easy to print. We supply the district residents with them at town hall. Judy Travis is the district liaison, our district manager. She's the one who gives them out. Upon request of Roaring Brook Lake, we can get those. It's a little late right now. We're in the midst of the summer. It takes about, the backlog has been about 30 days to get them printed. So we're talking almost the end of August before we get them. But we can get them if that's what the district would like to see done. And then they're affixed to the car, a side window or front window, wherever, as long as it doesn't obscure your vision. And it's easy. Then you walk by. If the car has a sticker, it's good to go. If it doesn't, it can be reported then that we have a non-resident here. And multiple ones can be issued to families who have multiple cars. That's how Hilltop is done. And it works out very well. Also, Lake Peekskill lives by beach tags. Each family is issued how many, the amount of tags based upon the amount of family members. You got 10 family members, you get 10 tags. You must have that tag when you walk through the gate at any of the Lake Peekskill beaches. And there's a monitor there that will check the tag. If you don't have one, you're not allowed on the beach. Even if you claim, well, I left it home. Well, if you left it home, go back home, get it, and bring it down. They're issued every year. So that's also a possibility. Beach tags, car tags. And they're easy enough to get, and we distribute them. We ask the residents to stop, see Judy, and she will, give them out. So that is a real possibility, and it's a good way to secure your community, to know who's there and who shouldn't be there.
Okay. There's a question about access to one of the hiking trails on Oak Ridge. I think the implication is somebody's blocking that entrance with their car. Again, who do we contact to deal with issues that relate to any of the hiking trails accessible from the lake?
If the hiking trails are on district property, not on private property, that you just call the sheriff and we can move that, and that has happened. You have to be careful though. Some of these trails go through private property, and the private property owner has the right to keep people off of their property. You have a myriad of trails. I remember walking up a trail going towards the cemetery, trying to find the old cemetery on the side of the hill, and it ended up going through the backyard of somebody's private property. And I was very apologetic when that occurred. I felt very badly about it. I didn't realize that their property extended to that area. So you have to be careful. But if there's a car blocking an entrance, Roaring Brook has a lot of public and state property. Part of Fawnstock is there. You have where the old building, I forget, HH something or other was going to be built. That's all state property now. been taken over by a conservatory. None of those can be blocked. And so it's just common sense. But you have to be careful. Make sure that the trail you're on is not crossing private property, because a private property owner certainly has the right to keep you off.
Okay. There's a question of permission or swimming and whether that's permitted from the boat launches.
Again, you have your swim beaches where the lifeguards are. Swimming where a lifeguard is not, and we state this very emphatically, our insurance companies will cover us on this. If there is no lifeguard there and it is not a designated swim beach, your swim beaches are Spur, Park, Children's, and Moon. That's it. If you swim from anything else, you do so at your own risk. There is no law or ordinance keeping them off, other than you should not be there swimming. You swim at your own risk. God forbid a tragedy happens. That tragedy is on you. I hate to be that blunt, but that is the truth of it. And our insurance company has assured us that as long as our four swim beaches are designated, and they are, and they all state only swim when a lifeguard is present, you risk your health and safety by swimming where those lifeguards are not. And that really is the extent of it. You can't prevent, somebody from getting a boat, swimming, let's say, to Cardiac, and Cardiac is no longer a swim beach. It is not. There is no lifeguard posted there. It is not part of the designated swim areas. But if you take a boat there and decide to swim around the shore, you do that at your own risk and any of the other boat landings, Ferber, et cetera.
Okay. There are a number of further comments around Airbnb.
Right.
I think we have to, as you said, take that subject off. One resident asks about when calling the sheriff, that they often put us off to either the Property Owners Association I've lost it now, but that they don't address it and they want us to deal with it ourselves.
It depends on what it is. They will do anything that is from a misdemeanor on up. In other words, a parking violation, like blocking a trail, they'll respond to that. They'll respond to destruction of district property. They have responded to that. What they won't respond to is, for instance, going beyond the allowed attendance at a beach. That's not their issue. That's the Department of Health in a town. And I will come down if necessary and say, listen, some of you have to leave. And then if it doesn't happen, I get the Department of Health involved. It really depends on the issues. The biggest problem I have with the sheriff's department and their response is that they are overwhelmed. They have though we're one of the smallest counties, it's a lot of acreage and a lot of lakes. And many of the towns, just about all the towns, have the same problems we're dealing with, and that is people not following the regulations of the beaches and things like that. So they're very thin, but if somebody gives me an issue, I will address it with the sheriff, and I have to be more expedient. One of the biggest problems we have is when a lake is frozen and people take their vehicles on that. Motorized vehicles are not allowed on the lake, whether they're frozen or not. Motorized vehicle is a skidoo. You can't have that on the lake. You can't. Or a car. Some people try to bring cars on the lake. The sheriff is a little slow on those responses, even though they risk health and safety. They've been much better. Sheriff Langley, I've had a couple of long talks with him, much more responsive. So first reference is go to the sheriff if you think a law is being broken. If it's something to do with the district that is not of a criminal nature, vandalism or anything like that, it needs to be brought to the town then, Judy Travis or myself. And I can be contacted over the weekends. It's real easy. I'm on Facebook all the time. I go to every community's Facebook page and review it. Sometimes I may be an hour or two late to do that, but I try to scan them all. You can contact me easily that way. Also, if you call town hall, 845-526-2121. I retrieve those messages 4 or 5 times a day. Usually I don't get many on the weekends there. I get more on Facebook or email, but either way you can contact me. Again, you have to understand the sheriff's only going to be involved with criminal matters. That's his domain. Anything beyond that or less than that becomes a district issue. And that's where the Department of Health or the town needs to be involved.
Okay. I know you're reading the chat as well. I mean, there are an awful lot of sort of comments here. I think some of those relate to taking responsibility for monitoring into our own hands to some degree. But I think the issue, Sam, always becomes enforcement.
Yes.
So we could potentially have volunteers doing a better job of monitoring. I think the issue around enforcement is, we have to deal with the...
That's where a security guard, and I know that was brought up, is not a bad idea. We have never had a district utilize a security guard. They used monitors, but monitors are just there to check tags or whatever, or make sure that the lifeguards appear on time. They're not enforcement agents. A security guard who could go from beach to beach just checking things, they, licensed though, they need to be licensed and insured. That's a must, or the town cannot employ them. That can be a big help. I know other communities use, hired security guards to do that enforcement mechanism. And the way it works is that they don't have arrest powers, but they have a connection right with the police department and can say, listen, this is security guard Montague, whatever. I have a real incident here. I need to get a car down here. And that will bring, the sheriff there quickly. Mm-hmm. Enforcement is law enforcement. When you're trying to enforce the crowds on a beach or something like that, lifeguard doesn't have time for that. The best the lifeguard can do is do a head count, call Judy or myself, and we respond in kind. And then if need be, we get the Department of Health involved. The problem with involving the Department of Health, and I hope all the residents understand this, they have the power given them by New York State to close down any beach they think is not in conformity. You experienced a terrible, what I called the reign of terror on Spur Beach for years, where the department wouldn't even consider opening it up. Finally, thanks to Jackie Anabi and Dr. Neshawat, myself, we met together, we opened that up. Granted, it's a toddler beach, but it's open now. It's a usable beach. I don't want to see any of our beaches closed, and they have the power to do that. So that's important that all the residents need to keep in mind and need to police themselves. Look, this virus has knocked us all for a loop. These restrictions are onerous, whether at town hall or your place of work or even in your own home. We're spraying packages. We would never think of doing that, in the past. And I know reference shaking hands with people. I can't even do that anymore. And I'm a big huggable type of guy. I love to greet people and stuff. We're limited by what this virus has done. And it has brought up a bunch of roadblocks. So it's just complicated an issue that is complicated anyway, especially with the restrictions of the amount of people that can be on beaches. And that enforcement is difficult unless we have a hired security guard that can actually be a liaison to the law enforcement agencies and respond. Again, it would have to be a situation where people refuse to listen at all. And I don't believe that's the case for most of our residents. I think if they go to a beach and see it's crowded, they'll try another one. That's my great hope.
Okay, Sam, I guess a question about district codes and our ability to influence them, how that works and what we would need to do in order to update them. I think there are other, I've seen myself and I think other board members have seen, there are different levels of fines. There are different restrictions and rules.
Right.
In fact, even, rules that pertain to renters and renters having to agree to a set of rules before they can sign a lease. So how would our owners association address changing some of the district rules.
You would organize yourselves as a, with the way Lake Oskawana did it, in 1988, they voted in this thing called the Weed Control District, Lake Oskawana. It's now called the Lake Oskawana Management Advisory Committee. And they had a set of rules in 87. I was council person at the time in the early 90s, 1993 and 94. They revised those rules. They met together as a committee with the district liaison. That was me. And we sat for about, it had to be a good dozen meetings, focusing on the rules and regulations to govern the waterways of Lake Oskawana, the speed that a motorized boat can go. They do allow motorized boats on that lake. It's the only lake that allows it. Where the boats could go, swimming privileges, the swimming beaches, etc. Roaring Brook can do the same. They would need to meet as a small group, get their existing codes or rules and regulations of the community out, and I would be there because I'm your liaison to Roaring Brook. We would sit down and we would codify and change whatever rules and regulations needed to be changed. Then the town board would vote on them. We would, you know, have a public hearing, then we would vote on them. And, you know, if accepted, they become effective. And those are the rules and regulations that the community would have to follow. It's in the hands of the homeowners association. They would step forward. Now, right now you have a recognized group called the Roaring Brook Advisory Committee for the dam and things like that. It would be through that committee that this would be done because that's the town recognized committee. The homeowners association, we acknowledge it, but it doesn't have the standing as an organization assigned status by the town board. Your Roaring Brook Advisory Committee does, though. And that would be the committee I would work with if that's what they wish to do.
Okay. I'm not sure. I know a lot of folks are writing stuff, and it's all good content. It doesn't really constitute questions in a way for Sam. I think that
there's one from Sam Lee that he wants to ask.
Asking about question about the dam, but I don't know where the question went.
It's all right. I'll ask the question. Can everyone hear?
Yes, Sam. Go ahead.
Good morning, Sam.
How are you doing?
Good morning, everybody. For those neighbors who don't know me, I'm the dam custodian. I've taken that role on since 2017. And the question I had, Sam, and I think we talked about in passing and then COVID came along, but we had some recommendations from GZANY Associates. Those were the dam engineers who gave us our dam spillway stability report and basically cleared us, gave us a clean bill of health.
Yes.
Our last dam inspection, but they did offer some recommendations to install some piezometers to check for the soil stability around the face of the dam. So I wanted to find out where the board was in terms of trying to get those piezometers installed for testing or at least price it out for us.
We were given an offer, right? We did follow up, Sam. Your dam and Lake Peekskill's dam. Lake Peekskill's a whole nother story. There actually has to be work done on that dam. But your dam, to do the testing, $25,000 was the offer that they gave. I was going to bring that up at the budget process in August because there's no rush on that. We can do that during the fall. If the community agrees to that, we can initiate that work then. But we did contact Chris Adams, who's the number one expert on dam maintenance and dam repair. He has an engineering background, also an environmental background. And he also, you know, had shared what you had shared, Sam, and that is, look, the dam is good. We did the stability, but we want to make sure it stays good. And there are certain measures they can take to ensure that its continued operation is safe and secure for years to come. But again, at a cost of $25,000, we just couldn't initiate that without having the budget process there. So that is on the agenda to be brought up when we do our budget meetings for Roaring Brook.
Question related is basically, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, okay. Can you hear you?
The metal brackets which hold the 9 wooden stop logs with the spillway boards, they're pretty rusty, malleable, and the way I have to secure them is hammer the boards in with a wedge, and I'm just concerned that one day there'll be a crack or it'll be compromised and we won't be able to hold the water level at full summer height as we experience it when the valve is closed and the water spilling over the spillway. So my request is just to see if we can get some eyes on it and maybe some estimates to replace
them. The gentleman that fixed the spillway itself did all the repairs on the spillway, fixed the cracks so that it was acceptable during the stability investigation. That same gentleman would do those metal brackets. He has the ability to get them and configure them. So if that's a need, and it sounds like a real important need, we can move forward with that and I can get some estimates, especially from that individual since he's so familiar with the dam spillway and stuff. You work with him, Sam, you know Joe, I think. Yeah, okay. And, he has that ability to subcontract out to a metallurgist to secure the metal, and then he can do the adhering and the cementing. He's pretty good at that stuff.
All right, thank you.
No problem, Sam.
Sam, is there one place where people can find out about public hearings? One more specific question about how will we know when an Airbnb specific meeting is taking place? What's the way for people to?
The best way is if you can scroll it on TV. I know you use Comcast and not Optimum, so it may be a little bit different, but our webpage announces all public hearings and everything else, and it's simple. PutnamValley.com. That'll get you right to us. That's our webpage. You just pull it up, and we announce, by law, we have to, our public hearings on that first initial page that appears the minute you look at a public hearing on so-and-so. We'll be doing that because we have four public hearings set come August 5th. They'll be occurring on four different issues. We have our Pine Valley Fire Department contract we're going to be discussing. We're going to be discussing some changing to our agricultural codes. And these have been ongoing in our meetings. We're looking at putting a moratorium on any large green energy project, that is windmills or more than 5-acre solar panels, things like that, just to have a study where the best locations would be for those things, because apparently the state is pushing green energy in a very big way. And we have to anticipate that. And finally, we are also proposing a ban on recreational marijuana in Putnam Valley. It's not happened yet, but I believe the state will pass that. And we feel, because we have so many churches and schools and things spread out, that a ban on the sale of recreational marijuana would benefit the community. But again, those are public hearings that will be slated, and they will be on our webpage. Public hearing on the Airbnb is huge. It's going to involve the entire town. That will be posted on our webpage too. Look forward to seeing that in late August or early September, because the board needs to discuss what exactly it is they want to present the public. And then once that's codified, then we can move forward and bring it for a hearing with the public. So they're announced on our webpage. That's the best way. I also post very important public hearings on my Facebook page. Not everybody does Facebook, and I understand that. So the webpage is the best way to go.
I just posted in the chat, Sam. I just posted those links in the chat for the town calendar and
the town calendar. Good. Thank you.
And for the public notices.
Thank you, Tony.
Yeah, we're running low on time. There was a question I missed way up top, and that was whether or not the northbound exit to Pudding Street is expected to be closed at any point, and if so, for how long? I think that was the question. It's from Judy Rappaport.
It will be closed for approximately, from what I've been told, 2 to 3 weeks. 3 weeks is really extended, more likely 2 weeks. Late spring of next year, that the last thing they need to do is to put the wings, the buttressing on the supports, and that's when they need to close it. It won't be happening soon, probably a little bit less than a year from now, about 10 months from now, maybe 9 months from now will occur, but it will be quick. They will set the framing up, pour the cement. The cement takes about 10 to 15 days to set, and then open it up. And that's when the actual traffic, some traffic, will be able to proceed then.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
I know, unless I missed anything, I think I just heard my clock chime 11 times. I'm muted for it. But I think our time's up.
I just want to thank everybody for joining us in on this Zoom meeting. I'm going to read all the chats. So if you had additional questions or statements, I'm going to take them into account. I'm going to review each one and, you know, respond in kind. Please know that the district is your district. We simply provide the services, and we're a outlet for you to get the services that you need. But ultimately, the decisions in the district are your decisions. The town board will do nothing unless we know that the majority of the community supports it, other than those issues that involve liability, like a rope swing. I'm sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. I know it's a bummer. I really do. But a rope swing is simply not allowable unless it's on private property, and then have fun. I used to use it back in the day, but that was back in the day, and things change. Thank you all for you know, tuning in, and we'll be speaking again soon. I'm sure of that. Thank you.
And thank you, Sam, for your time, and thank you everybody for coming. And yes, to be continued.
Thank you, Ina. Have a great weekend, everybody. Enjoy the muggy weather. Bye-bye now.
Thanks, Sam.
Bye-bye.